Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira thumma amma ba'd. So, manners of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa sallam as mean of fortifying our iman in this life. Now, I know when it comes to the subject of akhlaq and manners, many people, they consider this to be a cliche. Kind of like we talked about this a lot. Every time we want to talk to the youth, we have to hammer them with behave. And the best behavior is the behavior of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the kids are getting tired of this. The youth are getting tired of this. You know what? What does it mean to behave well anyway? I mean, does that mean that you have a certain standard that you're going to just fit in? And if you don't, then you're not a good Muslim? Does it mean that if you don't have a specific, you know, kind of like etiquette, that means completely you're out of the fold of Islam? What does it mean to behave? What does it mean to follow the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? That is something I want to share with you, inshallah. So at least we take the concept of manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the right context, and we make something applicable, something that we learn from and we follow, inshallah. But we need to understand why is it so important when it comes to the manners and the akhlaq of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, Muslims living in areas where predominantly ruled by non-Muslims is nothing new. But doing it as we're living it today in America and the West in general is a new thing. If you check the history of Islam in the past, Muslims lived in Europe for many, many years. They lived in the middle of Africa, lived in Asia and other places. A lot of non-Muslims and patches of Muslim communities here and there. But that wasn't out of the ordinary because they were local over there. They're original, they're indigenous to that society. But for the Muslims by choice, to come and travel from the Muslim land to the non-Muslim land, that's never heard of before. But now, we passed that stage, we're moving to stage number two. Muslims are born over here right now. Second generation and third generation. So it become more indigenous to the society. But then, why is it we don't see that the Muslims who once went to Africa, once went to Indonesia, they were able to transform their societies to Muslim societies, but the Muslims who are living in the West, living in America, they're unable to do that. As a matter of fact, we're gaining backlash instead. Instead of people welcoming and saying, wow, I want to be a Muslim like these guys, we're seeing the backlash right now. What went wrong and what was the big difference? The big difference goes back again to the principle we all now talk about this. It's the subject of manners and akhlaq. You see, when the Muslims went to Indonesia, they went to Africa, they went as merchants, business people. And everywhere they went, they carried with them their etiquette, their akhlaq, their manners. They carried with them their attitude. They carried with them even the concept of honesty, decency, justice, fairness. They carried with them the akhlaq and the manners of the good merchant. Things that when people used to see, they will be impressed by. They will look and they say, wow, these people are out of this world. They're amazing. And slowly and gradually, with good manners and akhlaq, subhanAllah, no matter how many barriers you put between you and other people, we just kind of feel, we start breaking all these barriers down because of good manners and good akhlaq. How many stories you've seen and you read about and probably watched recently on social media about somebody acting so mean towards some other Muslim brother or sister, but that brother or sister, they reply and they reciprocate that meanness with what? With goodness, with good manners. And then these people just got like melt down. Like, wow, I didn't expect this. I didn't expect that you got to reply like this. And then subhanAllah, you break all these barriers and then suddenly they become friends forever. It changes their view on the subject of Islam as Muslims because akhlaq and manners, they truly mean a lot. The difference is that the Muslims back in the day when they went to Africa and Indonesia, they carried the akhlaq and the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So for that reason, these people, they believed and they followed. Here in America, the Muslims are living here, we're living extremely radical, individualistic culture. Everybody's for themselves. People, they're fighting to be the best. They want to be specifically in the age of the selfie culture and the Snapchat culture and the self-centric culture. Everybody wants to be the celebrity of their own selves. And as a result, we're willing to step on other people's, you know, territories and rights and akhlaq and manners become irrelevant in this kind of competition, unfortunately. The akhlaq and the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they're very important. Because even if you don't think it's so important to you, but to us collectively as a society, as a community, we need that. Otherwise, without akhlaq and manners, what is going to happen to the world? You see, when the Prophet ﷺ, he migrated from Mecca to Medina, the people of Medina, they were waiting for him outside for hours and hours, days and days and days, from the morning until the late afternoon when it gets hot and the Prophet didn't arrive, they go back home. So they'll be waiting for him, hundreds of them. But you know what? Many of these people didn't even know who was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They've never seen him before, but they were waiting to meet him. Why they were so eager, so excited, so happy that they want to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Because the year before, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent to them what we know today as the first ambassador in Islam. And who was that man, Jama? The young man. What was his name? Mus'ab. Mus'ab ibn Umair. When the Prophet ﷺ sent him with the group that came from Yathrib, and after a year, hundreds of people embraced Islam, and they haven't seen the Prophet ﷺ yet. To show you how much they were eager to see the Prophet, when the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and that small caravan with him came in, people were looking and they're trying to figure out who was Muhammad. They couldn't tell. They look at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, they look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which one is Muhammad? They didn't even know who was Rasulullah, but they wanted to meet him. When Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he saw the confusion in the eyes of the people, he radiallahu anhu took the outer garment, he took his cloak off his shoulder, and he shaded the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the sun. And when he did that, the people looked at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they said, ah, so that's Rasulullah. They were so excited to meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where all of this came from? Came from a simple message. His student, Mus'ab ibn Umair, he displayed the greatest degree and level of mannerism and akhlaq. It is for that reason, they thought in their mind, if this is the student, can you imagine the mentor? If this is the product, can you imagine the source? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when he came, everybody was flocking to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi. They're so excited, so eager to meet Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi. After all, the fruit doesn't fall far away from the tree. Ask the Muslims today, and specifically for the next generation, inshallah, of our youth brothers and sisters, who are coming up, for hopefully, bi'idhnillah, as they carry in their hands the banner of Islam for the next generation, in which manners are we doing this? The akhlaq of the Prophet ﷺ, they mean a lot to us. Because no matter what you say, no matter what you do, people will look what you say and what you express to them in terms of dawah, they will go back and see how you behave. That is going to be the thing that will determine if they should follow your lead or not. Do we have Mus'abs amongst ourselves today? How many of our Mus'abs live amongst us today who really, truly, they are actually preaching Islam through their actions, not just through their statements? Akhlaq al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's manners were perfect for human beings. And as a matter of fact, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was praised in the Quran for his manners. Allah Azza wa Jalla says to the Prophet about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You're indeed a Muhammad on a great standard of character. The best manners, best akhlaq, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what does that exactly mean? People, they, as human beings, if you guys know, we have two faces, right? We have the public face and the private face. The public face is always the smiling face, the happy face, the one that you show right now in the conference when you go around, right? But when you go to the hotel room, that's when you get really upset with your kids. You have two different faces as human beings. So some people, at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they went around checking with the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, كَيْفَ كَانَ خُلُقُ النَّبِيِّ sallallahu alaihi wasallam, asking about the manners of the Prophet. Now what do you mean by that? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a public figure. He's all over the place. You want to know the akhlaq of the Prophet? Go to the masjid. Walk with him for some time. You'll see him. He's in public all the time. Watch Khutbatul Jum'ah. And you know for yourself the akhlaq and the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That wasn't what they were asking about. What they were asking about is his private manners, his private akhlaq. Because we know in public he's going to behave that way. But what about inside? Is he that like us? We have, you know, the double standard. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she heard him asking the question, she wanted to finish this quickly and just kind of end it there. She said, "Kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an." Like, hey, stop it. Don't ask these questions. Because كَانَ خُلُقُ الْقُرْآنِ the Quran or his manners was the Quran itself. Which means he doesn't fluctuate. Whatever there in the Quran, he follows it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's not just for the barakah. We read the Quran for the barakah. And we memorize the Quran just to get the title. But we don't put that Quran into action, into the practice of the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is the essence of being a young Muslim? Because alhamdulillah, one of the largest Muslim organizations we have in the country is Young Muslims, right? And what does it mean to be young Muslim, Jama'ah? I mean, a lot of us, we kind of lost the title M in the young Muslim. So we just have young brothers and sisters. Is it actually young Muslims right now? That's going to mean the most. Are we doing what we're supposed to be learning? Are we having the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in our personal life like we do it when we get together? How much of that are we practicing? The akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will mean a lot. The meaning of being a Muslim, it means actually to be a good human being, a better human being, a better citizen. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he summarized the mission of being a Muslim. The mission of his dawah. And that's the mission of your dawah as young Muslim, young brothers and sisters. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِيُتَمِّمَ صَالِحَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I was sent to the people to help them perfect their character, their manners. Means the entire message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the entire meaning of doing salah, siyam, when you give charity, when you help other people, when you smile on other people's faces, when you do this, when you do that, all the things that you do in order to identify yourself with being Muslim is being a better human being. Perfecting your manners and your akhlaq. But if you're being a human being, perfect human being in terms of your speech, your skills, your way of dealing with other people in terms of, you know, academia and this and that and so on, what's the point of your manners, akhlaq, do not reflect any of that title being a true Muslim? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for his akhlaq and his manners. He said, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيدَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّ مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. That if you were harsh and hard-hearted, they would disperse away from you. They will not come around you. What does that tell us? If you would like to be that Muslim, if you'd like truly to be that person who will take that message to the next level, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, it's important, it's imperative that you display and you hold on yourself to the highest standard of character. Because here's the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was instructed that if you want the people to be around you, soften your heart. Soften your heart to them. Care about them. Make sure that they see that and make sure that it's genuine. See, one thing we learn about the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that he, salawatullahi wasallam alayhi, he dared to care. Today, our youth are being taught to be, you know, self-centric, to love themselves more than anybody else, to get attraction, you know, towards themselves, and that's why they compete and they fight for likes and for followings and comments and all that stuff on social media, unfortunately. Many, they care about that so much so that they lose themselves in the process. And I talked about this last time, those who attended the lecture, that you need to make sure to maintain, you know, a healthy relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a personal level. Yes, as you try to promote yourself as a da'ya, as a speaker, as inshallah ta'ala, a good source of information and good source of you know, da'wah for people, don't forget about yourself. You need to learn to care about other people. In time and in age that people don't care much about others, we need to care about them. And that's why Allah, the Prophet ﷺ was instructed to care about other people. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. What does it mean exactly to care about other people? You see, as a Muslim, good manners needs to be observed in almost every aspect of our life. Every aspect of our life, whether it's business, personal, marriage, whatever that is. Look at something very personal such as the subject of marriage. When people get married, and by the way, I do a lot of, you know, marriage counseling and premarital, young men and women, they come to me and they ask me, can you help me find somebody, inshallah, for me? Parents come to me, can you help me find someone for my daughter, someone for my son? I say, what are you guys are looking for? What is the first thing people look for? Can you guys tell me?
Beauty.
Huh? The guys that say beauty, thank you. Huh? Khuluq wadin, that's unrealistic these days, unfortunately. I know. Huh? Money, status, the job, maybe has to be from Hyderabad or something like this. Whatever that is. They look for so many things. People, they share different values and to decide which is the, who is the best person for my son, who is the best person for my daughter. But the Prophet ﷺ instructed us to look for two valuable things in any person. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا جَاءَكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوا. If you find somebody, who, if someone comes to you to propose to you, and you're satisfied with their deen and akhlaq, what does it mean? Their deen, that means their relationship with the Creator. And akhlaq, manners, their relationship with the creation. If you find someone like this, says زَوِّجُوا, accept them. No matter what. And then he said, if you don't do so, تَكُنْ فِتْنَةُ الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ عَرِيضٌ. If you don't do that, you're going to cause a lot of fitna, a lot of corruption on earth. Unfortunately, you know, subhanAllah, I was walking last night and today, me and my wife, we're talking about it, and just like, subhanAllah, all these young men and women, and we're still having a problem finding people to get married. All over. Because we have different standards. A standard not unified anymore. Back in the day, it was very simple. Look for the manners and akhlaq. Now we're expanding that. Why? Because we have these selfish needs for that. And as a result, obviously, we start coming across against each other's personal needs. And that's where akhlaq and manners mean the most. How would you interact with other people? The manners of the Prophet ﷺ are very, very important. Why is it so important? Why is it so important? It is very important because when it comes to akhlaq and manners, really they define who you are. What you do in your life, everything that you do, the way you talk, the way you walk, where you go, where you take things and how you take them and all the stuff, and so on, even how you behave in the, on social media and the virtual world, all of these things, they define who you are. Why? Because your character is nothing more than just constant micro decisions. These micro decisions that you make when you decide what to say and how to say it, what to do and how you do it, all these things, they decide who your akhlaq and your manners, who your, what your character is going to have. So these things are very important for us. So how do I deal with people? I need to make sure that I deal with people in the best manner, best akhlaq. Do I reciprocate based on how they treat me? The answer is absolutely not. You don't treat people based on how they behave towards you. No. Otherwise, if you're going to do that, Allah musta'an, we end up with just kind of like killing each other. Instead, we deal with people based on our standards of mannerism, not theirs. Why do you need good akhlaq and good manners? Even in business. Even for those who would like to be successful after they graduate from school, they would like to go up higher in the ladder of business and career and so forth. What is the most important thing there? I know competition is a good thing too, but when it comes to akhlaq, it's higher and much more important than intelligence. There's something called IQ and something called EQ. IQ is basically is your academic, you know, intelligence, your brain, the way you think, the intellectual quotient. But then that doesn't qualify you to be the best, you know, business person or the best doctor, the best engineer, the best manager and so on, or the best teacher. What qualifies you to be that is to have the EQ, which is the emotional quotient. And that is basically the level of akhlaq and manner and how do you interact with people. So focus on your manners, focus on your akhlaq, even for your own good. That's very important in all aspects. Marriage, social life, business, school, relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you need that. Now, the last point I want to share with you. Being realistic. When we talk about akhlaq and manners, obviously I keep saying that the high standard of character and that the standard of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But is it even possible? Is it possible, can we in this age implement the akhlaq and the manners of the Prophet ﷺ so perfectly like he did ﷺ? The answer is, I wish, I hope so. But let's be realistic. We're living in a generation that is completely different. And when we talk about the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, which is why a lot of our young men and women, and this is a message for the parents in particular and their educators as well, when it comes to bringing examples from the life of the Prophet ﷺ and the companions to the young brothers and sisters of our time, we always bring them specific names. Like, let me ask you this question. How many of you can count 100 names of Sahabis? Raise your hand. If you can count 100 names of Sahabis, 100 names. How about 50 names? Okay, we have a few hands. 25 names? 10 names of Sahabis? Okay, how about 5 names of Sahabis? How many can count 5 names of Sahabi? Come on, that's all? Almost everybody, right? So if you cannot count 100 names of Sahabi, where did the other 1,000 companions go? Whenever we bring examples for our children, we always bring the example of who? Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Umar, Anas radiallahu an, Aisha, Fatima. Very common, very famous names. And we say, this is the standard of character. But you know, that wasn't all the Sahabis. The list of Sahabis going on and on and on, and some of them were just, you know, average people. Some of them were Bedouins. Some of them, they committed, you know, mistakes and made sins and they were punished for it and so on. So the Sahaba among themselves were not all perfect. So when we talk about perfection in terms of manners and akhlaq, we need to understand and teach ourselves as well that it is a process. Getting to that level of standard of character, remember, it is a process. It's not like one thing you acquire, and then what? Whether you have it or you don't have it at all. Please don't treat the subject of akhlaq and manners as being so solid like this and static, that whether you have it or you don't have it. No, it's a process. What does that mean? Because a lot of us, the young ones specifically, in the process of perfecting their manners and their akhlaq, they make a lot of mistakes. And when every time they make a mistake, what happens to them? They feel discouraged, disheartened. People, they start criticizing them. And they start putting them down or saying, oh my God, you do this? Allah musta'an. Shame on you. Oh my God, how could you do this? So they feel really discouraged. And as a result, they say, what? You see, I knew it. I'm a hypocrite. I can't be among these good people. So they quit. Don't listen to that. Reaching that level of mannerism is a process. And you will try, you will continue. You'll make mistakes. It's all right. It's all right. I will keep doing it. And every time I do something wrong, I'll fix it, inshallah ta'ala. The similarity to this can be found actually in Surah Fussilat, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about dealing with difficult people. He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَالْسَيَّةِ. The good and the bad, they're not equal. اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي أَحْسَنْ. Always repel, always respond in that which is best. فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. Perhaps with whom you have hostility or enmity becomes the most beloved to you. And then Allah says, وَمَا يَلَقَّاهَا إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبَرُوا. Only those who persevere in patience can handle this. Only those who persevere in patience can hold on to this. وَمَا يُلَقَّاهَا إِلَّا ذُو حَظٍّ عَظِيمٍ. Only those who do so will get reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is telling you, be patient no matter what with other people when they don't reciprocate your kindness. No matter what, be patient and Allah will reward you for it. And then, as I try to do that, I'll make mistakes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that very well. So He said, وَإِمَّا أَنْزَغَنَّكَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ نَزْغُ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ. If the shaitan whispers to you, which means if you try and you make these mistakes, and the shaitan kind of like deceives you, and the shaitan tempts you, and you just stop doing good and do something bad, like if you lose it one moment, it doesn't mean that's it, that's the end of the road. No, recalibrate. Seek refuge with Allah Azza wa Jal. Go back again to this path of goodness, inshallah ta'ala, and continue. Remember, reaching the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, absolutely, it's the ultimate goal. Realistically speaking, it's a process. You're not going to become Ibn Abbas all of a sudden, or Anas radiallahu, or Aisha radiallahu ta'ala. No, you're going to probably be that anonymous Sahabi at some point, and then slowly and gradually upgrade your level, inshallah, until you get there. And even when you get there, you're still a human being after all. You will continue struggling, and you continue to strive, and you continue your best to perfect your manners and the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's very crucial that we observe that, but we need to start from somewhere. And I hope, inshallah, that you guys will get the chance and read the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Learn from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the little things, the little akhlaq and manners of dealing with people before anything. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make among those who have the best akhlaq, ya Rabbil Alameen, and make it heavy in your scales and bring you closer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. سلم من جنة الفردوس الأعلى. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته.